So we got program managers here, also come. Make up clear. Alright, so my plan is that programming language theory is good to know about. Otherwise, we'll be talking about it. It's good for understanding how languages work, comparing them about how languages are going to work a lot of the time, and coming up with new languages. If you start going down the FP rabbit hole, eventually you'll come across blog posts and papers that some of them contain notation or definitions that you might not be familiar with. And a lot of it, not all of it, but you know, some of it is likely to come from the PLT literature. And yeah, once you're comfortable enough to get started, you can generally keep going. So there's a few little bits that people tend to hit, but they're very, very fun. This is them, with animated LaTeX slides to try and make them less frightening. And after that, you should be good to go with the models. Well, you have a map. So, yeah.
Yep,
okay. If I do it, screen it over my brain. Testing. Yeah, cool. I came across some of this notation when someone said, oh, that's what PLT is doing. And on page 2, they added a language feature in 2 columns to prove that it worked, and then spent 14 pages discussing the consequences of that change. And you seem to use some notation that was consistent for the term and the type changes, and it just made no sense to me. But I wanted that superpower. But yeah, we just had that, and then things happened. So that's how I got here. That and caffeine and time. So it's not as scary as it seems. That's not the same when you're scared. So. Hopefully not too much stuff to cover, and that's going to be good. I'll do a better answer. Right, so here is a thing from PLT and how it's usually presented. Notation. We're going to be covering that. If you don't find that scary at all, then maybe you've already covered this or you're used to this notation. But when I first came across that, I had no idea what was going on. So, this is about getting you started with it. Maybe not fully comfortable, but at least not scared. There'll also be little bits of, not just notation, but also bits in the domain of languages. There are a couple of them on it. And if you want more of this, there's a textbook, Types of Programming Languages, where you prove the various properties of what we're talking about in pen and paper. Or there's software foundations where you prove using the computer, so you don't need pen and paper, and you can automate proofs. Both very, very good, both kind of out of the script in this talk. But this will, if you like the flavor you get from this, is plenty more to tap into later on. Cool. So, the first bit of the notation we will cover is the natural production rules. Most of the things we use in this, with 2 exceptions, are going to be done in the star. We have a little nan, or nan, as I like to pronounce it. Above the line, we have the assumptions that must hold for the rule of apply. Beneath the line, we have the conclusion. That's very abstract, but let's get concrete. Evenness across natural numbers. 0 is even. That's what the top rule is saying. It has no assumptions above the line, so it's an axiom. If you're familiar with proof systems, axioms are the things that are just true. Below the line, we're saying x plus 2 is even, provided x is even. You're even above and below the line, so it's a recursive rule, which is fine. And we union all the rules together, and whatever rules we've got, and the union of them is, that's what we're planning. If we lose something out, then it's break, we put too many things in, and we might be okay. And we're only applying one rule at a time. So in that sense, the order that we apply the rules doesn't matter. When we go into this thing, we want to make sure that that's still true. We can check that later. And we're dealing with open world. So we can add things in later on, go back and modify things, or we should. Right, so let's add some stuff. So now we have oddness added in, and there's a lot of stuff going on. But if we're trying to prove the evenness of four by looking through these rules, we can do we can add two twice, get that to the zero, or we can jump through even an odd until we add an end to a plus two. There's a few different paths that you could apply these rules. And that can be confusing. But what the main property we're looking for here is the determinism. No matter which path we take to get there, it should always give the same answers. All the paths aren't scary as long as they're consistent. If they're inconsistent, then you've got something that probably isn't PLT at that point. You've just got a rule system that's doing stuff, which could be fun. Occasionally you'll come across some things that are clearly not fun. It could be mathematically convenient to specify rules like this. The symmetry rule there, you can just keep applying that any even number of times and you haven't really gone over yet. So you can have if you did a breadth first search, if you did a depth first search for all the derivations, you could also go across a term. It just keeps it going, increasing. But it can be useful for, if you're doing a whole of proofs and you're really looking for formalizing things to have that rule system upgrade. So if you come across something that looks like that, it's normally there for a reason. And if the author of the paper or blog post doesn't hit you, they'll also give you another set of rules called the algorithmic rules that help drive an implementation. They won't have the same nice mathematical properties that you're shooting for with the other ones, but they'll generally have the two sets of rules, one of them for maths people, one of them for engineers, and they'll prove that the rules are logically equivalent. So it may be a little bit harder to pull out what you need for the maths from the algorithmic ones, but the proof of the rules is enough that you've got soundness. So that's just a little bookmark for if you run into stuff like that. Because depending on which paths you have, you can run into that quickly. And then just grab the algorithmic ones and keep it. There's a little bit of Haskell here. Who's not comfortable with Haskell? Just show of hands, no shame. So the point of this talk is not about Haskell. The reason the Haskell is here is that the core of Haskell is to show that one, the code exists, and I'm not just saying, yeah, you're doing this. And the code is actually quite short. So that's the only reason the Haskell's up there. If you don't know the Haskell, check the phone for a minute or two when I get through the Haskell bits. Or use it for inspiration. I'm going to learn other courses at one point, but I need to learn that because this is really great. So, white noise playing for non-Haskellers, for everyone else. If we have an applicative F, manages some kind of effect, we could, for some of them, we could make an instance of the alternative type class. So empty is the kind of nothing going on value. And then we have this effectful or operation. So we give them two things, pick one of them, and I'll usually be left biased. From the maybe type, we have one of these instances, so two nothings, which is nothing, as you'd expect. If we have just a one and a nothing, it'll choose just a one. Nothing and just two, it'll choose a two. And because it's left bias, we get just one. Alright, so that's two things. Well, if we have more than two things there. Well, I'm glad you asked. We have the ability to take a container of all these things and compress them down. We just go through them all, apply what you would if you want to apply. That looks like this. These three things, pick the first one. Pick the first one, it's not nothing. If we give it nothing, we get nothing. Okay. All of this is leading up to my crazy implementation of the rule system, which is again just a proof of existence that you can do these things that is quite obvious. You got it, it's not on the test, you don't even remember it. A rule set is goes from A to B to D, so it may go from some kind of term to another term, or just a unit to say that this property holds. Even we go from the natural numbers to unit, so this thing applies with the non-linear value if the rule applies, if the rule set applies. The individual rules that make up a rule set have access to the rule set, recursive, so you can do those recursive rules. And this is how we do it, which is the crazy tiny bit of the So each of the rules, we run over them. We run the rule with the rule set that we're currently creating and the value, and then we sum them together and then we're done and we write no one asks us too many detailed questions if they're not comfortable with those in this entire block. But they just kind of jam it all in there and run away, and then you don't need to know anything more about that. Alrighty. This is what a rule looks like for an axiom. This is like limit 0 is even. So if x is 0, then yes, the rule applies. Otherwise, this is not what we're looking for. That's 0 less than 0. Is it at 2? Because we use ints rather than naturals, it's a little bit icky. So we just check it within bounds and then recursively call the even rule on something a little bit smaller. And we put them together and we have our even rule. We can pass in the odd function and create the odd, and pass in the even function and create odd even. The details don't really matter. We put them together, we even put in a whole bunch of rules, and here we go, even plus 3, not even. 4, even. 3 is odd, and 4, not odd. So it's odd. So the rule system works in that little program convention. Nothing up my sleeves, it's the whole point. Let's write a language. That's right, we've done the simplest language I can think of. A language of integers. So we're going to look at terms for our whole integer language. This is the kind of formal messy way of describing the terms. We have integers, these little triangle brackets, etc. Just regular integers rather than having any other introductory forms. Or we can add to it and go. These are the pieces of the language and ways of combining them. It's for the recursive definition. It's also referred to as the abstract syntax. It's not the concrete syntax because we don't care about commas and spaces and whatnot, but these are the pieces and ways of combining it with kind of grammar of it. And thus, and of course, doesn't count. Here's an integer. And in that schema, here's another integer. If you can have them together and still in an integer manner. I can write the Haskell version of this. Integers just wrap up a Haskell integer, add recursively these two terms in it. And then I can recreate those terms in Haskell. So this is my three in the language. And this is 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 fit. Lots of ads, stuff going on, but it's just a data plug, but a value of data. So, what are the values for each language? We're going to define the values for this language to be just integers. It's a subset of the syntax of the language. So, just by looking at the pieces that make up a term and how they combine, you should be able to point something to that. That's about it. There shouldn't be any kind of extra computation there, is it? No, we should just go and look at it. We could also go by rules, which helps around putting these things together. Right. So when we evaluate a term, we're turning it into a value. So the values are the endpoints. When we're evaluating 1 plus 2, we're watching our value. We get 3, not much more to do with it. That's the point of values. And the part of the syntax of the language. So if you're picking out something from the parts and how to combine those values. Now the evaluation itself proceeds in steps. And these set of steps, in this case, we use these small steps in the for language. They're what it means to, what does one question mean? Well, it means you evaluate things and then they through. That's not syntactic. Now, the steps are specified as a binary layer. T1 arrow T2. And that means that T1 can step to T2. That takes one step of computation, and it's just a little bit closer to being better. Right. So, for addition, the important bit is that if you ever have two images, and you've been told to add them together, you should add them together. This is important. If you don't have two images, well, panic, if the left-hand argument can take a step, then take the step and pack it back up, and then you're a little bit closer. Now, assuming the left-hand argument is already a value for an integer, but the right-hand argument can take a step, then you take a step and you pack it back up. And once any of those things hold, assuming no one's crazy past because you've got a protocol language and began to string in there, you can add an empty frame to the side and you can totally do that. This is also introducing small bars so that it's kind of doing that first evaluation. You could design a language that is biased towards the right, that's cool. And we use a little bit of a notational convenience. Rather than testing the T1 as a value, we just use V rather than T to refer to it. And there's an implicit test that we did in EA2 that the first argument is a value. Save some timing, and you'll see that everywhere in the literature. So that won't surprise me. Well, it might, because there's a lot of stuff in this talk and you're going to forget tons. But the slides are all fine, so we should be. Right, so this is the complete semantics of our literature. Step to the left, and then jump to the right, and then adherence, and you can do it. Right. So, a few definitions. These things will float around, and you can see the mysterious or the same thing as they're not, so we're covering them. If the term can't take a step, it's a normal form. Values can't take a step by definition, so they're normal forms. If you iterate the small step relation, it's going to reach a value. It's called evaluation. Just keep stepping, get a value, evaluate. If you just keep stepping until you get a normal form, that's called normalization. And at this point, people are like, that's the same thing, right? You group for the same thing. If everything is right, the world is the same thing. If the term is not a value, but is a normal form, so we've got something that's built on pieces, what do we do next? Yeah. Then it's stuck. And so you can normalize it, you can have it out of it. You do not want stuck terms. We'll get back to that in some detail soon. So if someone says a language is normalizing, it means there's an evaluation order through which you can take a finite size term and get it into a normal form in finite time. If it's strongly normalizing, it means the evaluation order doesn't matter. Pick up the scheme and go for it, and you're going to get there. Strongly normalizing is good. It means your finite times evaluate in finite time. And you can take that to the back. No holding problems here, you've got that saying. And that is a great problem you'll have if you can get the work on it. So we've already got something cool going on. We've got values and normal forms and similar things, but values are purely syntactic, and normal forms are semantic. And then we've got this relationship between them. And then this is all of that stuff. We've got these concepts coming from putting those two things together, which I find cool. It's a cool looking coming. This is all complicated definitions. If you see a big error, then you're dealing with big step semantics, which is tell me how to get to the end, how to jump right to a value, and compare the term of small step semantics and big step semantics using this thing. And then you don't have values. Values, big steps are values, and then, just if you see that, you'd be well equipped to pick up a textbook and understand it after this. Right. So, let's be an evaluator. We're going to do this addition from the example before, and we're going to do it with another form of this syntax that pops up all over the place instead of the right one I can't cross. This is an easy one to get started, and we'll do crazier and crazier ones as we go along. So, what are we adding? 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4. Well, what rule should we apply? Well, is this first argument a value? Here. So, the EA1 rule, which we see on the right there, applies. So we shift that up and have a look at that. Value on the left, value on the right, add into the class. Alright, 1 plus 2 is going to become 3. And that has been dragged down to the lower line. And so that's our one step of the evaluation. 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4, and 3 plus 2 plus 4. That's what we've got. We'll bring it down to our next step, and we'll do something similar. 3 is a value. 3 plus 4 isn't. So add together to make it a value, we bring it down, and then we have 3 plus 7, which is 2 energies added together. And then we've got 10. Hey, just a little bit too far away. We can do this with rules. Is non-Haskell project is built, we have a very simple set of roles and parameters. And we have this big thing, this value, now it's sort of works here. 10, so my value thing is working. For running for our rules, if we want to step our left-hand term, then we recursively use our step function to move forward, and we package it up again. This is making use of the fact that we're in the menu modem, so that if we can't step, that panel will just go in and we'll modify, which is handy. Stepping on the right, with access to a value function, looks like this. Check the first element's a value, and then step the step down and package it together. But we could just peek, because we've got a very simple language. And so if the first argument is, these are the values, and start folding this stuff together. If you're actually writing a value, you're probably folding the rules together, because it's more efficient. But, you know, some people, sure. And then adding integers together, unpacks the integers, adds them together, repacks them together. Right. And we list the rules, and we have a step function. So, with this piece, if we step it, we can see 1 plus 2 became 3. If we do 2 steps, with 3 plus 7, if we do 3 steps, we have 10. This is just like our diagram before, that in Haskell and not pilot. If we do another step, we have another step adaption. No rules apply. If we wanted to automate that, we can just keep applying the function until we hit nothing and then show the film just before, and we can just do that function. So that 4 lines of code thereabouts, and then we just say eval back. So we have an evaluator for the list of rules. It's good. So we get our first property that we would like to hold, which is that our terms are not stuck. I'll put the maths up because you'll come across the maths and the definition of these properties. Eventually get used to it. So for all terms, the term is either a value that's able to step. There exists another term that we can step to. That is something that we quite like. This is another existence proof. As well as writing code, I've written some property based tests for this, just to show that there's nothing on my sleeve or to show that these things fail. You can randomly generate terms. Here's a whole heap of them that randomly generated. The top line one is the one that initially generates, and we'll check some code to see whether this property holds. And if it fails, it will shrink it to these things to try and find the minimum counterexample. So that I don't have to try and test a whole heap of stuff. I can just say, this should hold for all terms, and we'll find that the smallest one of these that fails will tell me that everything is good. Cool. So we have a property that says, if you give me something that you can generate, and 2 rules, make sure that if one of them is nothing, the other one isn't. So exactly one of each rules will hold. And I'll use that to say that exactly one of them in step will work for the terms. And the main thing I'll just do is that works. Try 100 different random values, if you have a problem, but shrink it down. My tiny, simple language is implemented for in my 2 dozen lines of code, whatever it was. Alright. So, enough of these simple languages. Let's do another simple language. Booleans. True, false, and or are what we're playing with. True and false are values. Or is the thing we're doing. We have 2 different versions of this. One of them, our OR function wants to have all the information we get hold of. So we're going to fully evaluate both sides down to values and then use a truth table-like construction to pick out the result. If we don't want to know about all of them necessarily, we can just evaluate down on the left-hand side, and then once we get a concrete value, we know what to do next. So false or term is term, true or something is, who cares? It's true, we're done. And that's a good preview of lazy residue. We're going to do a little bit more of that, but that's kind of where it's coming from. And it feels very different when you're applying it top down using a lazy language, for instance. Or it can, but those are the origins of it. So master version, false true and all, a value, false is a value, true is a value, and those are all of our values. For the eager version, we step on the left, we step on the right, if the left side is a value, and then we have a big truth table. And we put a big truth table together and we have either or. For the lazy version, we do a short second, combine them, and we're good. So, let's do an eager step of this one, and we'll collapse the left diagonal, and another eager step, we'll collapse the right diagonal. The third eager step, we're done. And fourth eager step is no bueno, because it's a value. If we do this lazily, we'll go down on the left, and it'll be true. The second step will just give us the answer. We don't need to do that computation on the right, because we know enough. And going further stops. Another property, these rules are deterministic. For all terms, if the term can take a step, and if there is some other step that we can take in the initial term, both of those outputs will agree. This comes into play in fancier languages when you're doing it purely mathematically, but it's a good property for us to have in Haskell land, because in maths land we have sets of rules and we have lists of rules. So we kind of want to make sure that the order of our rules is important, because the theory says the order is important, and if depending on them somehow, they're probably broken. So again, we randomly generate terms, and we say, given our rule set, just randomly shuffle it twice and create the rule, you know, if the rules are different order, if the rules are in different orders, you create the rule and then run it, it should be. And then we say that the eval rules should be deterministic for the lazy and the eager evaluation. And it is happy. There will be a slight one too. We can step it up a tiny bit more in the simple cases, and then we'll do something interesting. Natural numbers, we've come across them before, they're either zero or the successor of a natural number. It's kind of a year in number system, just how many things you have. And you just add them up. So zero and successor are our natural numbers, and predecessor is the function we're applying to these things. In the eager case, our values are zero, or the successor of any natural number that is composed purely of successes and zero. So, zero is three, and that is totally a value. In the lazy case, if it's a zero, if it starts with a successor, it's probably good enough. And if it's got some other stuff in there, we'll do a couple of them. So this is clearly one, successor is zero, in eager case. It's got some work to do in the eager case to resolve what it actually is. But in the lazy system, it's totally a value. Natural numbers are zero successes in the case. And if there's some computation in the thing, then we'll find out about that later, and that'll be fine. So in the eager rules, we step through our successes because we need to get it to a value there. We step through our predecessors. Predecessor is zero and zero. We run out of natural numbers at that point. And the predecessor or the successor of the value is just the value. But we need to get to the value first, so everything else needs to be conscious with. In lazy land, we step through our predecessors. If we hit zero, we return zero. If we hit a predecessor-successor pair, we just return whatever's inside of it. No more computation, just get rid of that pairing and we get this useful info. Cool. So, on the lazy evaluation of both of these are one. It's only a one in the eager case of the first one. If we're doing eager evaluation, we don't want any computation in our values. That's kind of the core thing. And the lazy evaluation, we don't want to do any work that we don't need to. So that's the core kind of tension between the two. So this is fine in lazy land, zero successor of a number. But if we use the predecessor, if we take the predecessor, then we're kind of tickling it and saying, hey, wake up and give me an answer. So the outer predecessor pair will be removed and we've still got a pred, so we've still got questions to answer. If we leave it alone, it's successful. No one calls properly, no one cared about it enough to ask, so we just leave it. Cool. And if the name is zeros around you, I can probably just blast through this because I don't think we use it much. Step through successes, processes, zero, and the easy version. Also, yeah, great, cool. So, eagerly, we step through this, it peels off the pair, and we get one, and we keep going, it stops. Lazily, you don't even say. As a successor, it is a day. Whereas if we wrap the predecessor around and ask a question, then everything still works with eager, up until the point we did earlier. And we actually cause the lazy version to do some work until we get started. And it just works. Cool. Now, this is where things start to get a little bit more interesting. We combined Booleans and natural numbers. And then because they sit in their own little domains, we have a few functions that cross the screens, which is good, apparently. So you can check whether something is zero, and then run if then else. These are our new little non-verbal forms. If we're checking if something is zero, then we keep stepping through. If it's zero, then we say true. If it's an accessor or something, we say false. Under eager semantics, we'll wait until it's a value before we answer. Lazy semantics, as soon as we see a successor, like when we know our answer, and we just ship it. And if we step through our initial, and if that hits true, we take the first branch, and if it's false, then we take the second branch, because you don't want to do both in the standard, and then decide. You kind of do your condition one first. It's kind of like inherently lazy. So now, we have a stop turn. This is not a value, I can't take a step. Is zero false? What do you do? Similarly, if zero, then false or true in a same language is not something you can consider. But one thing that happens in books when you do this is they break values down further. So you have your Boolean values and your natural values, and you combine them together, and you have your rules. Hey, run this, it's going to be good. Just a natural value. Cool, this is still stuck. It doesn't help you that you've restricted it to, you know, you have communicated intent very clearly, and that's excellent. But it doesn't help you look at a term and say, oh, that one's going to be a good problem. Because you're going to run it until you hit something. And so here we have the, you must be exactly one of the value of the step, and I ran my random test, and after 14 tests and 5 shrinks, it came up with all 0, 0. And it's like, that's not a value, that can't take a step. And same for the lazy and ego said, process with false is it's good. Alright, that's better. Alright, so what we want is to work out which terms will or won't get stuck without having to evaluate the term. Because it could be altering problems or outcome reverse problems, you know. I've got this implementation of the acronym function, and I just want to make sure that it's, you know, well typed, but I'll just wrap it a bit. So, this is where types come from. We have two types of denoted, rules and mats. We're using them to classify kind of the sorts of things, and this is a cheap method to classify, to attempt to classify things into stuff or not. This is the typing relation. It's ternary. It's one of the scary things that I ran into the first time I saw it, because I didn't know what was going on, and it just looks broken. I'm saying little t is well typed, and has typed big T inside of the context gamma. So I'll take it back there. So we have some context, some information, and based on that information, we say the term has this type. At the moment, we don't have any relevant context, so we just have middle two plus type big T. And we can begin. False plus type boolean. We don't care about context. True is also boolean. If T1 and T2 are booleans, then OR is type boolean. This is going well. And it's an open world, so I can say that, and not saying that that happens until then. We've also seen that we check something. I expect false to be a rule, but I will look it up. Yep, that's cool. We can also use it to infer. I have false, it's a time, and we can kind of methodically look through this and actually call rule out as the answer. So that's kind of cool. At the moment, we have what's called a syntax recognizer, so we can actually walk through the syntax together and infer and spin it like that without inferring or checking, which is a nice property to have, but sometimes you want a bit more power. That number will come up with in the future too. Natural numbers. Zero is a natural number, successor of a natural number is a natural number, predecessor of a natural number is a natural number. And the bridge between the two worlds. If t is a natural number, then e0t is a boolean. If t1 is a boolean and t2 and t3 are the same, then if t1 and t2 does t3 has that same time. This is a rules out the stuck terms we saw previously. Is zero false, doesn't apply to a wrong, felt out, be wrong. And if zero, then false, false true, also wrong. Unfortunately, we've ruled out a non-stuck term. This term is not stuck. If true, then zero, else true. We'll always evaluate to zero. But our typing system will reject it. Oh no. Actually, it's fine. We're dealing with something called a conservative type system. A lot of types are super conservative. It turns out a lot of the time we can work around what we don't need or what have you. But just use thinking and other definition of the sneaky example. Cool. For each goal type term, we'll have a need type at the moment, or the whole way through this talk. Later we'll relax that and be more concerned with the principal type of the term. There'll be a family of types, and we'll pick one and say that's the one right. Alright, second series, work through of notation, possibly. We're going to type that term on the wall. But we're going to work out its type. So it's an if then else. So the two different parts. So we'll check the first bit. Successor is zero. And we'll need to check that. We need to check its item. Successor is zero. And we'll check that. We need to check zero. And then we hit goal. We know this one. Zero is a natural number. And that means successor of zero is a natural number, which means is zero successor of zero is brought up as a boolean. The next one, quite easy, false. False, boolean. Sweet. We've warmed up at this point. True or false? We check true as a boolean. We check false as a boolean. Both of the rules are all works. And now we have if, null, that's correct. Both branches are the same, rules. This thing is a boolean. If you do it without the colors in the talking, and you just stare at it, you have the potential to confuse yourself. Cool. We can implement this. We create our types. We start with checking. So give me a term type pair, and I'll tell you whether that is that term has that particular type. So is zero has type boolean that is correct, provided its item has type map. If we check the first one, it has type null, and the other two items have the same as the term type. And we have this bad term here that has successor and false in it. And if we check, then it's type null, we get nothing. Fix that up, we check it has type null, it says yes. Also, it does not have the type map. So we have a type checker for it. If we do these things to check whether or not types are equal and fail or not fail based on that, we can also refer to this. So this is taking the term and returning the type. So it's doing inference. So if is error, if the term has type map, then return rule, we give the terms to types. And if we check the condition has type null, then we check that the two branches the bring in the types and return that type. And from that, we can infer that the type of our build types term is nothing, and if we fix it up, then that comes cool, which is correct. At this point, if you go through the code, our probability testing gets a little bit more extreme. We start generating the prototype terms. and we can check if we generate a term with a given type, checking that term has that type succeeds, and inferring the type of the term agrees with the type that we generate. That works. Cool. All right, now coming up on a key point is good. There are two main properties for a type system that we want. And I relate the small step semantics with the type regulation, and it's pretty awesome. The first is progress. For all well-typed terms, the term is either attributed or is able to take a step. Just like the term is but the script for well-typed terms. And the other one is preservation. If you give me a well-typed term and it can take a step, then afterwards the type will be the same. And they give us a type set. The old type terms do not get stuck. So those combining syntax, semantics, and typing in one statement. And when we took people 30 years to get there, dozens of people working on it to bring the game, so that you get that little 50 bumpers to get a result. So progress means the well type term is either evaluated or taken. So if you're evaluated, you're done. Hey, you have evaluated something. If not, you can take a step. But preservation means that as you take the step, you still have that same time. And so progress applies. So you're either evaluated or you can take a step. And as long as you find what you sized, you're eventually going to be evaluated without exploiting, so you're not stuck. Hey, if you're trying to size your own well, there's all things about. Yeah, so they tie together a good three, and they give us approximate classifiers which terms one might get stuck. Proportional to the size of the term in this case. And you can implement this in probably worst testing of what the main thing is in the classes. And the next main thing is pizza, and then I'll come through and really call that in line. So this is where some of the payoff begins, slash the heavy notation, and more complex things. We're going to add Laing calculus into the mix. That involves adding three things, which will give us the ability to work with functions. Not functions from often, you know, someone who gives us the sine function. We're going to be creating functions out of whole cloth on our own, and then using that. So, hey. There are three things that we add to the language to get to this point. We have variables, like x there. We have what's called a lambda abstraction, lambda x and then t, which is a function, effectively, and then a function implication. You give me a function and an argument, and I'll apply the argument to the function. The only values in there are the lambdas. And there's no steps in variables. They're neither stepable, more values, so just by default, it's stuck. So, so, when we're dealing with a lambda, there's some. The x to the left of the dot is called the variable binding, and to the right of the dot is the variable itself. So we'll have a look at some terms. So this term means nothing. This is a variable x. No good. X plus 2 also doesn't pass muster. This, however, is fine. Lambda x plus 2 is the same as the function of the bottom here. F of x equals x plus 2. It's a function, it takes an x. The body of the function is x plus 2. We just haven't had one on command. If we apply 1 to that function, that is the same as f1. It's, you know, we just got brackets on the other side of things, and we have an f function. And if we evaluate that in hand slant, so f1, we take f of x equals x plus 2, and we replace all the x's by 1's. That's the step that we're doing. I don't really talk through that explicitly when I talk about functions in school, or maybe they do, it's been years. I'm going to say hello. We have notation for that, because we love notation. This one is go through F and replace every X you see with a 1. And we'd like to see something similar happening when we do a generation, right? So go through this and replace all the X's with 1s and drop the lambda because we've already used that. That should be good. We need to be careful when we're doing that. So here's something with a lot of X's, and we're going to replace the X's with the 3s. But there's a tap here. So when we do this, we want to get this lambda x, x plus 1, with 3 plus 1 applied to it. You don't want to go into that function on the left and replace all the x's, because otherwise you have a bad time. So in order to do that, we need to work out which variables we want to replace. We call the free variables. A variable is bound, which is the opposite of free, effectively. If it appears inside the lambda abstraction, with a variable only matching variable y. So here x is bound by the lambda, and then we use it, it's bound. Here x is free. Oh no, bad news. Well, as we're going that way. And a variable can be free and bound at the same time. So x is free here, but it's bound here. They're effectively different x's at this point. So what we really want to do is go through and replace all the free occurrences of x with 3. And that'll give us the right value. Replacing the bound ones, no problem. Everything falls apart. Cats and dogs live together. One thing we could do with the bound variables, one we can do at any point is to just consistently rename. One change the meaning of the program, and that kind of highlights the behavior we see there should be the same if those z's were x's, and that kind of highlights the go through and replace all the free occurrences, the bound occurrences are out of bounds. So, we have some rules, not in natural direction style. Sorry. I know you all love the natural direction style now, but this is what we've got. To determine the free variables of an expression. Well, the free variable of a variable is a variable. In a lambda, we grab the free variables in the body and we discard the lambda argument. For application, we just grab the free variables everywhere. Basically, we're just walking through, finding all the variables down the leaves, and then discarding one, the bound variable whenever we have a lambda. So we can walk through that with this bad boy. This is a function application. So we're going to be unioning the three variables on either side, like so. We have a function on the left. So this rule applies. So we're going to grab the three variables of the body and then strip out the x. Now we're going to apply some set theory. We have the set, three variables of x plus 1. We chop off the x and we union it with the set. Free variables of x plus 1. Well, that's just the free variables of x plus 1. And that saves me slide space, which is, set theory logic, all about slide space. For x plus 1, we take the free variables of both arguments, and the free variables of x are x, and the free variables of 1 is nothing. So, you can do that calculation, you'll see these rules, you come up in the middle of something that's doing that for the direction everywhere, and it can be a good surprise. So, now that we have the three variables, we can do substitution properly. And I have a shiny razor. You can see we can use the three variable thing there, in like one case, in this big other rule system. So, how do you write your three variable thing? This is how to replace x with s in all of these forms. In x, you return s. If you hit a variable that isn't x, then you leave it alone. Similarly, if you're hitting a lambda where that variable is bound, you leave it alone. Otherwise, you go through it and substitute, provided the thing that you're replacing it with doesn't have your bound variable as a free variable. Otherwise, you're going to be introducing variables that are going to confuse matters, and you stop and go renaming and it's fine. And otherwise, you just have recursively go through your term, doing substitutions on all the bits. a good example because there's quite a lot of content in that with funny errors. So, the function application, we need substitution for ESR. So, and then we're going to work with a ladder with the down variable. So, substitution for x and ladder x is low. And then we're substituting, replacing x with 3 and x with 1. We go to the plus, we go to both arguments. And now we're replacing x with 3 and x. So we finally get our 3, and then 1 is unchanged. And we're done on that thing. Alright. So, we used 3 variables in that one little place of the substitution rules. And now we have substitution rule defined. So we're going to use it one little place in the small scope semantics. This is as complicated as it gets. 3 levels of rules, and then you get the functions. You get used to it. In the ego semantics, if you're applying a value to a function, you step the thing on the left towards a value, and if that's already a value, you step the thing on the right towards a value, and eventually you can end up with a lambda and a value. So go through the body of the lambda, replacing x's with the arguments, which is what that bottom line says. Go through and replace x with the value in the body, and then you've done the function provision. If you're lazy, then you don't even get the value. Just as soon as you see an angle, just replace something, and someone else can compute it if they want to play it. The Haskell implementation, you aren't even Haskell, really look away. We have this term, which has a type variable A, which is for the type of variables in this thing, and it's a functor form and traversable, and it's a follow all across the 3 variables in this. And part of that comes from the script, like a type in A. We also have a monad instance, which is also across the 3 variables. Return is your variable, and our function is run on the variables, and everything else inside the monad is all about just recursively working through the structure towards these variables so you can do that replacement. We have that need script type in there, and we have 2 functions that we care about, extract and instantiate. I'm going to show them being used, but I won't talk too much about many metaphors for what they might be like. So here we have a function. It adds x to 1, and it is bad, because x is a free variable. And we can see it's a free variable by using follows to list, x is free and that. So now let's abstract over x in that function. And that will give us a scope with no free variables. It's actually, that little b represents a data variable. That is good to go. It is capturing things up so we're not going to get any name functions, because the bound things have gone away in the current now in names representation. And you can see no free variables. Now, if we want to go through and replace the bound variables with some term, that's what we'll stand for. And then we get bound 3 plus 1. You don't need to know any more about bound than that. If we take that function x plus 1 and abstract over y, rather than be constructed, we get the layer of f around it. So this is free, but I'm inside the lambda. And then x still appears as 3. And if we substitute all y's for 3 in that, then it unwraps a little bit, but otherwise, you know, there's no x's to deal with. Or that one way, no, there won't have y's to deal with. Cool. Right. So one little help function, lam, which takes the variable to extract over and wraps it up into a term data type. You can kind of see that playing out here, laying out over our thing. Gives us our term type with the scope inside of it, like before. And we can build up to the example we had before of labor x plus 1 with some things applied to it. And then we can go through, go find all the variables. If the variable is x, we get 3, otherwise, just wrap it back up in the variable. And off the bottom of the screen, but it's done with the same routine. So, let's how one user can extract. And this is extension rate is in the go through and do all the replacements in a way that doesn't snap on hands. Take out the function, and everywhere the bound variable will go and replace it this time. So that is, at that point, we've written our own functions that we can run with those rules. You can do stuff with it. You can build booleans and various functions. Don't do that. We already have booleans, but this is this cool part of it. You can build natural numbers in parameter squares, pairs, and then you can do recursion. It takes a repeated loop that applies a function kind of forever. You can use that to build, say, for top factorial. Again, don't do that, just a cool party trick, or maybe cool as overselling. It's a party trick. That can lead to trouble. If you've got this, and you step it, you end up where you start. So, it's not quite stuck, it just happens to not. And it's bad. And, as a bonus, there are plenty of stuck terms. This is criteria one. No one I'm familiar with doesn't even use one of them. So, get types. Right. We add type annotations to all of our bound items so we know what's going on. And we add a new type, which is the function type, from argument to return. The small step semantics are the same, except we put our annotations. And now we have our type equals. This is another point where it's here, but it's not all that bad. However, the gambles helped. The gambles are a map from variables to types. So any variable we've sent in before, we record it in there, and we know what type it has. If we hit a variable and it's in the map, then we just pull that type out with the type checker, and we're good to go. If X has type T in the context camera, then X has type T, of course. If it's not in that map, then the whole thing is ill typed. Some free variable is stuck in, and you don't know what to do. TApp, if we have a term, looks like T1 or T2, and we apply an argument, looks like T1 to that, we have T2 to that. When we're dealing with the functions, we take the argument of the function, x as t1, and temporarily generate the contents, so we can type check little t there. And then we have a function from t1 to the type of t in that information. If we didn't generate that, then we wouldn't know what type of variable was, or we print some other type and that. And at that point, we can type any function or any kind of simple type thing at this time. We work through an example, it's like false probably, and these were the easiest ones to work through the numbers going through. So given no context and this ID function with true reply to it, we have application, so we use the tApp role and then focus on that function bit. So we bring the context up. And we bring the function up. And we already know the argument is type rule, so we're at the top of that. And then we have the empty context, and we know that X is of type rule. So we've got a new context that says X is type rule. And then we need to say, well, what is the type of X? Well, it's cool. And then we need the return type of the function, so we know the type of that. And then we need it to know the type of true. It doesn't need the context, and it's type rule, so the whole thing is type rule. If you stare at these things well enough, and if you have three highways, it makes it easier, then we're pretty good. Alright, I can implement this in Haskell. There's a map under the hood that looks things up and works in the maybe one out, so it can pull things out to pull the type out. Checking error types is a thing that makes a little bit longer than some of the other rules we've seen. And we need to modify the context on the way through the language. But again, this is just coming up to the problem that we understand with the pattern. So I was inferring, going from term and context to type. We can also check actions in this. So here we check that the contents of the map has the right type for the variable. And then for checking the apply, to kind of find out the type of that T1 and the arrow, I actually use infer. So this is called bidirectional type checking. If I wanted to check a type, I could infer it and then check the infer type is what I was expecting. And this is kind of similar to that. I'm using inference as part of my checking and as fine. There are other ways of doing it. This is convenient and not found on the and then checking that and does the same thing with modifying the context. And yeah, now we've rolled out things like Omega. It rules out fix, or we can add that in later. It rules out enough, but super type only happens, or STLC, as it's referred to quite often, is strongly normalizing. It always, finite terms always become values in the finite number of steps. It's really that enough stuff that's really true. If we're happy to give it up, then we can get recursive in, and we can have to expect in. I'm going to have to expect in, but we'll do it very quickly. And the point isn't, oh, now I have the fix. The point is, if I'm reading that fix, I'm going to get this kind of thing as input, and I'm going to be able to work through the consequences of the rules and work out what it means for me. So we'll be given the syntax of it. Take a fixed point of t, whatever that is. The small step semantics, you keep stepping the argument, and then you do something awful. And then there's some type of rule that has clearly no connection whatsoever with the small step semantics, but it makes it. Yay! And that's what you'll find. If you pick up a book, you go, oh, sections do, and some type of that happens. You make pairs, types for all the terms. Semantics and timing and bits. This is how these things are presented with a little bit of, you know, a couple of paragraphs in it. But it's not terrible, right? The type of the first element of the pair, T1 and T2, is the type of first element. It's all notation, it's not having two errors going on, you can get the hardware. So, tuple records, variants, lists will all be similarly added and upload an exercise to handle this sort of result and have a bit of a think about them. There are still some things that come. Every time you want an identity function, you've got to put the annotations of the serial and they're pretty similar at the time. Const is what? So set two arguments and return one of them. And yeah, don't even need to start on the compose function and one of the various versions of that. This is because we have to annotate all of our binaries with a concrete type. And when they give part 2 of this, it might actually be part 3 if someone else has a talk in between on the way in rush and kind of plan for that. Then I'll talk about how we deal with that. So next time, I'll talk about extensions and flushing out this thing. So how do you deal with pattern matching, recursive types, use defined data types, minimal fixes and consts, ID things, you can have universal types, and inference, and then system references to it. So that will be future talk. For now, we've given a bit of a very different version of this previously. It's in the version 2 folder up here, so it will be explore the code or check out slides and improve them or however on your own.